can feel it. I can feel it. Yes, I can feel the excitement mounting within the bus. It's true, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to join the autobahn. The autobahn, here it is. Look at that. You can call them whatever you like. Motorways, highways, freeways, interstates, autoroute, autostrada. These roads, they're to be found in all developed countries. And their main purpose is to get us from A to B, or A to C, or A to anywhere, really, in the quickest possible time. But you know, here in Germany, there's a slight difference. And that difference is that here in Germany, long stretches of the autobahn network, there are absolutely no speed limits whatsoever. You can travel as fast as the cars, anyway, can travel as fast as they like. And people wonder, how come? Why is this the case in Germany? Well, the reason lies a little further up this road. We're travelling now on Autobahn number 5 in a northerly direction. And we're going to turn off and head up into the Black Forest after about 3 or 4 minutes. But were we to continue along this road, we'd eventually come to a city called Stuttgart. And it's in Stuttgart, you know, that's where they manufactured cars. Automobiles such as Mercedes-Benz and Porsche. I can imagine, if you're a Porsche driver, you might well ask yourself, what's the point of my driving a Porsche if I can only travel at 70 miles an hour instead of 170 miles an hour, which I prefer. And of course, the car manufacturing industry has certainly had an influence on successive German governments and persuading them not to impose too many speed limits on the autobahn networks here in Germany. Anyway, one thing about autobahns is certain, they do have a fairly straight stretch of road, and this will give me the opportunity of coming around and distributing some maps amongst you, so you have some kind of idea where you'll be heading today. So I'll see you in a minute or so.
This is the autobahn down there.
Hey there.
And you're from where?
Wisconsin.
Wisconsin.
Yep.
Midwest, you call that?
Midwest.
No place called Oshkosh.
Yep. Right.
A nice little high spot to build their nests, you see, and you often find that those high spots will be, for instance, on the roof of a church. But emphasizing the intelligence of the stork, you'll find that when they do build their nests on the roof of a church, it'll be on the opposite side of the roof from the bells. You know, they don't like to be woken up too early in the morning. Anyway, back to the maps. We've just stopped at Hofgut Sternen, the green blob there, and after Hofgut Sternen we will descend rapidly, and we'll drive right down through the city of Freiburg. Freiburg and Breisach, close to the middle of your maps there, and then we'll come to that crossing point once again. And this time, instead of going past the Kaiserstuhl wine-growing region as we did this morning, we'll continue in a clockwise direction, and we'll go around another wine-growing region called the Tuniberg, and we should get you back to Breisach by 12:17 and a half. If everything goes according to 12:17 and a half later. Okay, so that's something to look forward to. Anyway, that's about it. We might have another look at those maps a little later on. By the way, if some of your maps appear a little dark, bear in mind it is the Black Forest. For lunch to come along, and then they dip their heads into the river from time to time, and another fish bites the dust. And So look out for the grey herons as well. They're birds of the Black Forest, standing on a fence post or in a tree or on the field itself, waiting for lunch to come along as well. You'll see some hawks and sparrowhawks and falcons. The red tend often to be seen in groups, swooping and playing in pairs or in groups. And there are red kites, not to be seen every day, but with a little luck, we might see one of those or a couple of those red kites today. Now then, there's an interesting house, and it will appear shortly on the right-hand side of the road. You see these three relatively modern houses ahead of us now on the right-hand side of the road. After them, you'll see an old Glotter Valley farmhouse. And there it is there. See it. I know the effect is rather spoiled by that crane which is standing in front of it, but it is a typical old Black Forest farmhouse, typical in that it's built entirely of wood, of course, with a thatched roof on this occasion. Notice how low the eaves of the roof come as protection, of course, for the raw weather conditions here. Sometimes notice it's a hipped roof, it has no gable end. The roof is on four sides, little dormer windows, still functioning as a farm today, and that building goes back almost 430 years. So a relatively old building. Relative, I say, because this village that we're headed for now, it celebrated its 900th birthday. 3 years ago, I think it was, half-timbered houses there on the right-hand side, and you see a couple of those here. We won't see many of those in the Black Forest, but those of us who have decided to visit the beautiful medieval city of Colmar this afternoon, we'll see plenty of those half-timbered houses there. The little village of, well, it's not a little village, it's quite a large village of Lower Glotter Valley. A hotel ahead of us on the left-hand side, the Adler. Typical name for a hotel, of course. The Eagle, one of the similar. A Union Jack on the right-hand side. It's a Jaguar showroom, Jaguar garage there. Some more half-timbered houses. Another field of flowers on the left. It is Bloomin's, is the sign. And you see, there's the honesty box there on the left-hand side. That's where you put your money if you pick your flowers. Flower decorations and the balconies of the hotels, cascading from the window boxes. Every village has a church. And they're mostly Catholic around here. And one thinks of Germany as the cradle of the Protestant Reformation. But you know, here in the southern part of Germany, it's mostly Catholic. And generally speaking, the further north you go, the more Protestant it becomes. This is a big village, deserves a big church, and that's what it gets. And there's also a mural of St. Christopher there on the left-hand side. That's St. Christopher. An interesting in-hotel here on the left-hand side, the Zum Goldenen Engel, the Golden Angel, it dates back to 1507. So it's over 500 years old. Although they tell me that they have changed the sheets. In the meantime, look down to the left-hand side, see over the door, it says Rathaus. It's not Rathaus, it's Rathaus. It's the village hall. Well, some people say there are rats in there, but it all depends on your political view of it, I suppose. The stream, one of the good streams carrying down all that water from the Black Forest eventually down to the Rhine River. On the left, a field of corn, and on the hillside, vines once again. Now then, you know, there's nowhere in Germany where the vines grow at a higher altitude than here on the right, in the Glotter Valley. But even here there's a limit, and it comes at about 500 meters, about 1700 feet. Anything higher than that, no longer conducive to wine growing. But you know, if you came here a little later in the summer, perhaps the end of August, beginning of September, when the grapes are ripe and sweet, when they hang heavy on the vine, you'll find that many of these vines would be covered in a blue mesh. And I asked the vintner once, what's the idea of the blue mesh? And he replied, well, you have to protect your grapes, he said. You have to protect your grapes against the crows. You have to protect your grapes against the wild boar. And you have to protect your grapes against the tourists. Yes, indeed. Do you know, most of those who live in this part of Germany have escaped the worst of the recession. And they're not doing so badly for themselves, and you will see evidence from time to time where they're renovating houses and extending houses such as this one ahead of us. And of course, wood, timber plays such an important part in the building process in this part here, the part of the world. And look there on the right hand side, a little timber, a little sawmill there. A very small one, and that one, you know, still for inns where you can try some of the local delicacies. One of them is ahead of us on the left hand side. You see that bunch of trees? The northeast from here, they call themselves the Alemanni. Life hard, difficult, harsh terrain, harsh climate. They needed help, and that event. But there on the right hand side, best not tell them that the wolf is back. It has a diverse, 100 miles from north to south, 40 miles east to west, a diverse landscape including wide open valleys, meadows with blossoming trees, high moorland, deep cut inaccessible valleys. You can tell I'm reading this, but conical mountains with treeless peaks. You know, there's a line above which the trees no longer grow. And we have several of those mountains here as well. They call it the tree line. And the highest point is called the Feldberg. It reaches a height of 4,898 feet. Okay. There are several, many rivers which spring from the Black Forest. Including the Enz, the Elz, the Murg, the Kinzig, the Neckar, and the most famous and popular of them all, the Danube, also springs from the Black Forest, meanders its way then through Bavaria, Austria, Eastern Europe, and eventually flows into the Black Sea. So it springs from the Black Forest and flows into the Black Sea, the Danube. There are several lakes to be found here in the Black Forest, and some of the most beautiful are to be found here in the southern part of the Black Forest. The biggest of them is called the Schluchsee, but the most popular amongst visitors, it's called the Titisee. And people wonder why it's called the Titisee. Well, it all goes back to Roman times once again, and a certain Roman general called Titus are this ahead of us here. A typical Black Forest sawmill, timber mill. You'll see them dotted all around the Black Forest, these sawmills. And what's also typical, you know, is that they built their mill on running water, like this little stream which we're crossing now. Of course, they built their mills and their workshops on running water. Water, that stream would supply them with a ready source of refreshment, but just as importantly would supply them with a source of power. Power to turn wheels and drive some machinery with it. And this sawmill here, still partially water-powered today. So we talked about the evergreens around here. There are also many, you see plenty of Benedictine Monastery of St. Peter. There it is. And in the background you'll see the Feldberg, the highest mountain in the Black Forest. There's a little spot of snow still stubbornly hanging on there, but most of it is gone now. But that's the that monastery, you know, Benedictine monastery, it's been there since the year 1090. Over 900 years. It was founded by the Seringer family. You've never heard of them, but they were a very powerful family here in the Middle Ages. They founded the city of Freiburg many times over the Middle Ages. It had to be rebuilt or partially rebuilt at least several times. And that particular version was built in the early 18th century in a Baroque style of architecture, which was also the case in several of the other monasteries. And there are several monasteries. That is our first today. And look ahead. On the left-hand side, you see a garden. And this is quite Baroque as well. It's verging on the Rococo. Look at it. Yes. They started developing that about 2 years ago. They'll continue, I think. Look to the right. You'll see there's a field of red currants there. We're at an altitude of 2,400 feet now. And we shall continue to climb into the Black Forest before, for a while anyway. And those onion-shaped domes and on the towers of the church of the former Benedictine monastery there, they were, many people wonder, is that the... one reason why they're so big. Another thing, I know, you look to the left and you'll see a pond of water there. You see it there? You'll see a pond, another pond of water on the right-hand side. Very shortly there now, and there's, you know, there's a link, because these old farmhouses, you know, they would have been built entirely of wood. The framework, apart from the quarry stone foundation, the framework would have been built of wood. The roof, if it wasn't a thatched roof, it would be covered in shingles, like overlapping fish scales made of wood. The walls would also have been covered in these shingles. You can imagine what the furniture was made of. Wood, of course, plenty, so much of it around. And wood is a wonderful material to work with, and it's a warm material to live within as well. But there's a constant risk, isn't there, when you're living in a wooden house, and that's the constant risk of fire. And how did they combat this? Well, there certainly wouldn't have been any point in calling the fire brigade. Even if there was a fire brigade, you couldn't expect them to locate your isolated farm here. You had to be prepared, in other words, to fight your own fire. And one way they did that was by creating that little pond of water, very close to the farm buildings themselves, useful for watering livestock as well.
Wow.
Very useful for some drivers, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. Luckily, we have Miroslav, the greatest driver in the whole of Western Europe. He avoided that terrible accident. Anyway, there's another typical characteristic of Black Forest farmers was that they were invariably built on a slope. Why was this? Well, because it's very difficult to find a patch of land which is not on a slope here in the Black Forest, as you can see. And so they did this, and they turned this to their own advantage. And you see that most of the living quarters, not always, but mostly, they were on the part of the house which overlooked the valley. But look there on the right-hand side. You see the from the back end of the house, he could drive straight into the top floor of the house. There's a little pond of water there as well, and you'll find this is the case, you know. Even in the newer houses built here in the Black Forest, you'll find that from that part of the house which nestled against the hillside, he might build a ramp, but he'd find some way of being able to drive straight into the top floor of the house. And he'd use that then as a storage facility, as a hay loft. And you know, the farmers, they had another problem. It had to do with the religion. Not that religion itself was the problem. The problem was rather how to conduct your religion. Look down there on the right-hand side. Can you see the little chapel? Down there on the right-hand side. Cute little chapel down there. We're going to see another one on the left-hand side very shortly. And it was believed, you see, that they should worship, but that they should worship outside of the walls of the house in which they lived. And of course, if you lived in a close-knit community, like a village, a town, or a city, you'd have a communal place of worship catering for those who lived in the surrounding streets. But this was totally impractical here in the Black Forest. You couldn't expect these farmers and their families to trudge over long distances, and over one free day in the week, especially in winter through snow, to some communal place of worship. The only solution was for each household to build its own place of worship. And that's what they did. And that's why you'll see many of these little chapels around. And there's another one here on the left-hand side. This is where we'll make a little stop as well. So please remain seated. I wanted to tell you one or two things first of all. There's a chapel on the left-hand side. That's a nice little building. The two towers ahead of us, those are the two towers of the former Augustinian monastery of Sankt Märgen. There are three rules. You know, we're in Germany, and here in Germany, they do love their rules. And some of them are right. First of all, we're going to stop here for 5 minutes, so don't walk too far away. Be back in the bus in 5 minutes. Secondly, this curve, this bend here, is very dangerous. Okay, so don't cross the road, please. Thirdly, you see this fence to your right? Don't touch it. It's just a piece of advice. Don't touch the fence. Okay, enjoy your stay here, and be careful as you disembark. Thank you.
This is Lake St. Marguerite. Bunch of other Viking buses here. This would have been.
You get to go with the outfit on to see her in the native outfit in the Black Forest.
Hotel there. Just behind us there was another little house which had a sign over the doorway. It said Hundepension. In English, dog hotel. Oh yes, dogs love to come to the Black Forest for their holidays. You know all those trees? The dog's paradise, ladies and gentlemen.